Welcome back to your show Identity Zoom Club, where today we're talking about public finance management in Zimbabwe. Did you know that you have to be concerned about this issue? Oh yeah, you do, because you contribute to the revenue of this country and you have to be concerned about its expenditure. And also we had in the previous segment that you actually sometimes accumulate debt. When the government goes and gets a loan, it's on you and me. So we need to be concerned about the expenditure and the management of these funds. And in this segment, I continue with Honorable Mona. Honorable, welcome back again to the show.
Thank you, Nyari.
And I'm joined by Admire Mtizwa from ZCC. Admire, welcome.
Thank you, Nyari.
Right. Honorable, before we went on the break, we already had that the Treasury is responsible, the Treasury being the Minister of Finance. And what is the role of Parliament?
Thank you very much, Nyari. The role of Parliament is enshrined in Section 299 of the Constitution, where we do the oversight of our institutions, government institutions, departments that fall under our purview.
So you gave us the fundamentals, the background of public financing. What are some of the concepts of public financing? We just want to understand, kuti isusema citizens, jinomborevei, mamboshubatambitena, maybe if you could go deeper, Honorable.
Thank you very much, Nyari. I'm glad to say we've got about four broad concepts here. Mm. We talk of the public expenditure, the public debt, the public revenue, and budgeting. So those are mainly the four concepts of public finance in terms of how then the government engages in the issue of debt management, whereby every citizen is concerned about the total of debt the nation has, the expenditure, how the government spends the money that it collects, and then the public revenue, how it mobilizes resources. And we talk of the budgeting, which is the process in terms of the drafting, the approval, the implementation, and then the audit part of it. And all that is encompassed in Section 305 of the Supreme Constitution when it comes to the budgeting issues.
Fantastic. There's been a recent report by the World Bank, Honorable, that talks about the role, some of the issues of expenditure, especially co-expenditure. That also touches the Auditor General's, some of the Auditor General's outcomes of where there's been recommendations actually to say how the government can strengthen some of its weaknesses. You also mentioned Agenda 2030 in the new dispensation.
Yes.
What is it that we can see that's better, that's coming up as far as what you've mentioned in terms of the use of those concepts that you mentioned, especially when we're talking about expenditure? What is it that we're going to see better moving forward?
Thank you very much, Nyari. I'm glad to say with the advent of the new dispensation, in terms of the what we call the fiscal discipline, kuti vanhu vanojika mari yavanenge vainayo. This in this current dispensation, we've seen that we're actually spending what we have. So in terms of the surplus that has been witnessed over a few months, starting 2019, where the government was spending what was in their coffers. So in terms of discipline, in terms of managing the expenditure, the government has been doing very well in the management of expenditure. And I'm glad to say that if we continue on that trajectory, we see that, like what you've said, the international players, the IMF, through the staff monitored program, this is something the nation, the road that we must take in terms of managing our expenditure as a nation.
I'll come back to you on that. Admire, what are some of the principles and practices of public finance management that we should engage as Zimbabwe?
Thank you, Nyari. I think what I may need to add are the principles of transparency and accountability, in addition to what Honorable Mona has indicated. When we talk about a good management of our public finances, the government has to be more transparent in terms of where are they collecting revenues from, how are they using that revenue, and which strategic priorities are they spending more to, and how actually those strategic priorities came to being. And maybe in terms of that strategic priority issue, we then need to come to the issue of citizen participation.
Before we go to citizen participation, I want you to touch more. We just mentioned the issues of transparency and accountability. What are you talking about there?
The issue here, Nyari, is if we are saying the government is going to raise 4 billion, the government has to be clear in terms of what are the revenue lines. Is it tax? Are they levies from different institutions? Are they contributions from parastatals, etc.? And that information should be accessible by the public, meaning that the general citizens must be able to easily access the information in terms of how are we raising our revenue, but also in terms of expenditure. If we say that the government has spent more than what they have raised in terms of other revenues, the government must also be clear and provide the information to the citizens in terms of those expenditure lines.
Okay, thank you very much. I think that was very helpful in terms of making citizens understand what we are talking about when we're talking about transparency and accountability. And then briefly, as we wrap up, I want you to talk about, maybe both you gentlemen can, but starting with you, Admire, how then can citizens participate in public finance? Since Tap Tonzoti, can I chikwere chino turani government, I'm part of it, chikwere tinde changu, toto divide ranoti. Oh, pane 1 billion chikwere it. Saka kana chiri 1 billion chikwere it, means kuti pisi yangu ndinayo ipapo. Saka, tino participate say, kuti tizi yoti my income, my expenditure, so that mira saying.
Citizens participate in our starting at the policy making, framework. Honorable talked about the Vision 2030 and the Transitional Stabilization Program. That is the broader framework which is guiding the kind of development that we want. And it is unpacking the vision for the country. So starting at the policy-making level, you need to involve the citizens so that they identify the key development priorities, whether from the local level, but also at the national level. Then when we now come at the budgeting at a time when the government is now making the budget, the citizens, they have to be involved through consultative processes where the government, through the Ministry of Finance and also Parliament, it plays another key consultative role. They go to the citizens, asking the citizens in terms of where do they think that are the strategic priorities for the country in terms of development, where do they want to see more revenue going, but also in terms of what are some of the basic services that needs to be prioritized.
Thank you very much. Honorable Mona, quickly, briefly, 30 seconds.
Thank you very much. Maybe just to buttress what Admire said, we've got section 141 of the Supreme Constitution. It talks of the involvement of the public when it comes to consultations. So as we approach the budgetary process of trying to consult the public, we then go out to the public and gather their views. And not only that, Yari, we also have section 28 of the Public Finance Management Act, which subsection 5, it talks of the minister coming to the relevant portfolio committee to seek views relating to the issue of formulation of policies. And also public, they are actually mandated by section 149 of the Constitution to petition Parliament whenever they've got issues that they want addressed. Mm. So those are the platforms that we have in terms of public involvement.
Thank you very much. And I think how we can participate as citizens. We've already heard about the hearings that are sometimes called for. And I think as citizens, we must take it upon ourselves to be part of those processes, to go in and input. And I know also NGOs input in several ways. So we will continue with conversations. We are just taking a break. Stay with us.